Welcome and thank you so much for having the Hillcrest Academy Choir here in your church. My name is Carrie Bjorndahl and my maiden name is LeVang, and I like to share that because I work with alumni, and so a lot of times people remember me from high school or they might know my parents. So I'm Carrie LeVang Bjorndahl and I am bringing greetings from Little Fergus Falls, Minnesota. Your far-off community that's connected to you from Hillcrest Academy. I bring greetings from President Brad Hoganson. He's been traveling with us for part of the tour, but he is staying up in the Seattle area for a little bit longer to meet with people and do some meetings and different things up in those churches. So he's passed the torch to me to welcome you this evening and to thank your congregation for hosting us. As we get started this evening, I want to share a little bit about our choir. We have 44 students in the choir. Their ages are 9th grade through 12th grade. And they come from 5 different states around the United States. You may know that Hillcrest is a boarding school. Anyone from 9th grade to 12th grade can live in the dorm. Maybe some of you did. Anybody raise their hand out there that lived in the dorm? Okay, here's one. A couple more hands. Yep, there's two more back there. And it's a wonderful Christian community that is a boarding school, and I always describe it, it's a little bit like going to Bible camp. Actually, it's a lot like going to Bible camp, but you have to do your homework. So, so these kids, some of them live in the dorm, some of them live at home with their parents. We come from 5 different states in the United States, but 7 countries represented in the choir. So there are actually more countries represented than states. Some of those countries are, if I can remember all of them, Brazil, Korea, Vietnam, Nigeria, Norway, and China. And then the United States makes number 7. So this is a wonderful group of students who have dedicated this time to sharing the truth and God's majesty through music. That's what they're bringing this evening. So we say thank you for welcoming us and giving them this opportunity to minister. And I'm just going to open in prayer and we'll begin this evening together. Heavenly Father, thank you so much for being a powerful, strong, great God, deserving of all of our worship and praise. We lift up this time to you, this next hour and a half of worship to you, and we just want to bring glory to your name. I pray that the words of the songs and the beauty of the music would be a blessing to this congregation, and that we would all leave this place tonight rejoicing in the power and greatness of our God and the sure foundation that you are in our lives. Thank you for gathering this group of people together. Thank you for Jesus Christ, the one who's part of creating us and sustaining us and giving us life. In Jesus' name, amen.
With unmeasured praise. Deserts of your life, I'll not desert you. I will make a way beside a flowing stream. Through the valley, do not fear, for I am with you. My rod and staff to comfort and redeem.
In the darkness of your life, I will not leave you. In the shadow of your light, your lamp, your star, I will be the star that shines above to guide you.
Let your faith be stronger than your fear.
When you're weary, when you're faint, I will.
before you. Do not be afraid. I am by your side. Be still and know that I am with you. Let your faith be stronger than our
music in the air.
Above my head.
peace, eternal peace, a peace that overcomes all anxieties. You may have heard of the Hebrew word shalom before, and you may know that it means peace. It is used as a greeting, like saying hello, or as a parting, like saying goodbye. At least this is how it is commonly heard. But shalom means so much more than this. This peace is referring to wholeness, peace that gives wholeness or completeness. John 14:27 says, "Peace I leave with you, my peace I give you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled and do not be afraid." This is Jesus talking, and what a wonderful message it is to hear. This world is full of darkness and corruption, but Jesus gives us something so much more than what the world gives. He gives us shalom, a complete peace that covers over all the worries of the world. Do not let your hearts be troubled. I am with you. We should be so full of joy no matter what our circumstances are, because Jesus gives us something far greater than our earthly troubles, a peace that comes from the knowledge that he has overcome the world, and that because of what he has done, we are free from sin. Please enjoy Shalom by Dan Forrest with Max Anderson on the viola.
Thank you.
Sorry, I gotta get my notes out. Don't have it all memorized. All right. Well, I am Vincent Nash. I am a junior that I go to Hillcrest, obviously. But I look forward to giving my testimony, and I hope that you all can learn something through it. So I'll start off by kind of reading a verse that has kind of determined what direction I was going to take in giving my testimony, because there are multiple directions that could have been taken, and that is Psalm 78, verse 4. We will not hide them from our children, but we will tell a future generation the praiseworthy acts of the Lord, his might, and the wondrous works he has performed. So today, I would like to start off by asking everyone a question, and it would be amazing if you could raise your hand when you do it. Who all likes stories? Because I know I do. It looks like most of you do. That's a good thing, because there are a lot of things that would be stories. And I think that it's very important in our generation and every generation for stories. I think that there is a reason that Jesus taught in parables, that we love to go to the movies, we love reading books, we love listening to songs, we love to tell people about where we came from, we love to just kind of tell everyone about everything, and we do that through stories. If you didn't know, it's kind of interesting. I find that interesting because one of the greatest stories that we can ever listen to is the Bible. And according to Genesis, we are all created in his image, if you didn't know, because that's really cool. It's really something that you should know, because it's very life-defining to know that you are created in the image of God. And I hope that really sets on your heart, and that that's just something that you should be aware of. Significance of stories. Everyone has one, just as God has one. Since we are created in his image, it would be only logical that everyone else would also have a story. And as much as I would love to hear everyone's story here, that would take too long. So I'll give the example of my story. I grew up in a Christian home. I had great parents. I still have great parents. My grandfather was a pastor, and I love my grandma with all my heart. She's amazing. October 7th, 2020, my grandfather passed away. He was the greatest role model of Christ in my life, and he was gone. Skip forward a year. I was reflecting on that because that was my 15th birthday. He never knew. He was in a coma for his last month of his life. It was difficult. He never knew that I turned 15. It was kind of a traumatic experience, I guess, because every night my parents would drive to Fargo. That's an hour away from where we live, so they'd be gone for a while. I never got to see him while he was in the ICU because he was in a coma. He had wires sticking all out of his body. It just was not a pretty picture, so my parents never let me or my siblings go see him. And as I was reflecting on that a year later, just broke me. I was depressed, in a pit, cutting myself, hurting myself. I almost committed suicide twice. I ended up in the emergency room a couple of times. And that's where he found me. I was kind of just reflecting, as you do when you're depressed. You kind of just sit there, away from everyone, obviously, because you don't want to talk to anyone. And that's where he found me. I was broken, weary, worn, and sad. You'll hear that later. It was difficult. He pulls you out of the pit, makes you new. That's where I am today. I turned on him. He pulled me out of that pit. I turned on him.
ironic that you're 2 years later after I turn away from God, I'm here talking to everyone that you shouldn't follow him. But the significance of stories, why are they so important? Personally, I don't know. But God knows. And I think that's significant, because he chose to use stories for me to tell you that you should follow him. Jesus knew. That's what he was talking about in Psalm 78, verse 4. We will reveal them to him. Those are his secrets. They're not made secret to us anymore, and that's because he told us through them in parables. All throughout the New Testament, you can read about Jesus's parables, and you can stick yourself, you can try and find yourself in those parables. It's really interesting how such significant stories can even be used 2,000 years later and we still haven't reached the bottom of them either. I've been thinking about Genesis 32, I believe, verse 10, when Jacob wrestles with God. That story goes so deep. I've been reflecting on it for probably close to 6 months now, and I still will never be able to reach the bottom. You'll be able to reach the end of my story, here on earth, that is. I don't know where it's going to go. I know that one day I'll be in heaven with God, fully complete, clothed in righteousness with God. It's going to be amazing. I hope to see you all there. It's going to be great. We need to dig deep to know what the meanings of our stories are. We need to dig deep into these stories to know what the meanings of them are, because when they're not rooted in God, where mine wasn't in 2020, it gets dark really fast. I know from experience. But now, when I find my meeting in Christ, things turn around. It's been a great couple of years since I've come back. My relationships with other people have gotten significantly better. I'm more vocal in groups. My relationship with my dad suffered while I was depressed, and it kind of sucked because I honestly despised talking to him. It was bad. Whenever he would talk to me, I just kind of, dad's talking to me. Nasty. Gross. But it's been great. My parents, I love them. We need to know what the significance of our meetings are, what the significance of our story is, and if that's not rooted in Christ, leads to dark places, and you can find your hope in Christ. And I hope that's what I've been conveying to you all, is that you should find your rest in God, and build your story off of God's story, which he already laid to us throughout the whole Bible. All right, I'll end it there. Will you pray with me? Lord, I thank you for this day. Thank you that we were all able to get here. I thank you that we were able to get here safely through a long bus ride. I pray that you will reveal yourself to these people through these next songs, and I pray that I thank you that all these people were able to make it out here tonight. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
La 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 boom, 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 boom,
Our first objective is call to follow Christ in connecting our neighbors to Jesus. Our second is to foster, to partner in mission with individuals, congregations, and regions and synods and our disciple-making efforts. Our third is to unleash new leaders. We're looking for new ways that we can train a new generation of young adults to unleash their leadership in our churches. And here's one way we're looking at accomplishing this. Our synod has decided to partner with our Lutheran Brethren Tuscarora and Conference Center in Pennsylvania to start a new 5-year program called Rooted. It'll be a 1-year gap program for young adults between 18 and 25 years old. And the program, its goal is to invest in, educate, train, disciple, and empower a new generation of leaders within our denomination. If the program is successful, we hope it's going to be a pilot program we can place in other parts of North America. Our fourth objective is to multiply new disciples so that new churches can be planted and established and congregations revitalized. So here's some more ways we want to accomplish these objectives. In order to reach the unreached people groups with the gospel of Jesus Christ, International Missions has a goal to replace our retiring missionaries, which are starting to happen, and send an additional 4 missionary units over to the next 5 years to our various foreign fields in Japan and Taiwan and Chad, Africa. And we're all well underway in accomplishing these objectives. Paul and Alexa Fraser have arrived in our mission field in Japan this past year. And by the way, we have Alexa's sister Leah with us tonight, right up in the front row up here, singing in the choir. And her dad is also an LB pastor in Breckenridge, Minnesota. So the whole family is involved in ministry for Jesus. Another missionary couple, Matthias and Ellie Zabodi, arrived in our mission field this coming summer in Chad. And now Matthias and Ellie's story is so intriguing, I think they can make a Hallmark movie out of it. But they haven't yet. So since they haven't, and time doesn't allow me to share about the story, I encourage you to go to the CLB website, and they will tell you their story in person on the video there. So you may want to do that. A couple ways North American Mission is planning to accomplish these objectives is with church vitality. North American Mission is working with congregations to make disciples among their neighbors. And we have a goal to help train 25 congregations over the next 5 years to help them with their disciple-making efforts locally. We also want to plant new churches. We have a goal to plant 10 new churches in the Lutheran Brethren over the next 5 years. And so right now we're looking to identify and equip and send church planters in North America. And we have a desire to see people connect with Jesus, his community, and his mission. Because we believe when that happens, churches will grow, and churches will be planted. Our Lutheran Brethren Seminary is all about embracing the word and reaching the world. You see, it doesn't matter if a person wants to become a minister, want to be a missionary, or if you're a lay leader. Our seminary is here to help prepare you for the ministry God has and the mission he has for you to serve wherever that may be. At the present time, we have 39 students that are at the LBS Seminary. 12 of them are full-time, and we have 30 that are actually on distance. And what they're doing is, of those 21 are serving in congregations right now, and while they're earning their degree. Our seminary has set up a free disciple-making, a lay leadership training program called LB Discipleship Institute for people in our congregations. And some of the courses are elder training, how to read and understand the Bible, New Testament survey, and worship leading, just to name a few. And another way that we are planning to accomplish these objectives is through Hillcrest. As you've heard, that Hillcrest is now preschool through 12 grades, and we're proud that Hillcrest is another important disciple-making ministry in the Church Lutheran Brethren. As a matter of fact, many of our pastors, many of our missionaries, and many of our lay leaders are alumni of Hillcrest. The Church Lutheran Brethren has an app, and we're on Facebook. And so they're both two great ways to stay more informed of what's happening and up to date in the Church Lutheran Brethren. So we thank you again for allowing us to be here, and hope you enjoy the rest of the concert.
Cornerstone, written by Sean Kirshner, is based on Psalm 118, 22 through 23, which says, "The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes." Jesus came to earth, rejected by the world, died for us to take our sins, and has become the cornerstone to all who receive him. A cornerstone is a stone joining two walls. This made me think about how, as humans, we are sinful, and the Lord is perfect. Jesus' sacrifice is the connector. It is only because of Jesus' sacrifice that we are saved and secure in Christ. Listen to how this song is able to be sung with joy and freedom as the Lord is our cornerstone. This evening, our soloists are Max Anderson and Ella Knutson.
To the ground and suffer through the winter's cold, only to rise right up again and bear its seed a thousandfold.
Never can our journey fail. A little child will lead the way, whose eyes are filled with the shining light, to whom the night is bright as day.
Thank you.
So I just have the privilege of sharing for a few more minutes, and in my role as the alumni relations coordinator at Hillcrest, which is what I do as my job at Hillcrest, one of the things that I get to do is make connections. That's one of the favorite parts of the job. I also do a lot of party planning, which is also fun, but connections are really fun for me. And as I'm sitting back here looking at the audience and then knowing some of the alumni that are here tonight, I want to make a few connections for you. So we have a couple of class of 1990 members in your congregation. Jeff Cleveland and Joel Munson are both class of 1990, and up here, there are 22 different kids that are alumni kids. There's 44 in the choir. 22 of them belong to alumni. So Jeff and Joel, in this concert, we have Max Anderson is Don and Karsten Anderson's son, and Dokken Helseth is Lorraine Folden Helseth's son. So a couple of your classmates. I have a friend here who's part of the class of 91, and she matches up with two of my kids, Noah Bjorndahl and Annika Bjorndahl. And then there's a 1988, Janai, she is 87. Okay, so you're gonna know up here Merritt Ewan, her son, Sean DeCook, and then also Melissa Pribinow, Stokes Pribinow. Her daughter is Elise up here. And it's just so fun as these generations continue and we make these connections. And there may be many other connections that I'm not even picking up on in this room. But one of the blessings of Hillcrest is that connectedness. And we really belong to you, Lutheran Brethren Church of Nampa. Hillcrest is your school. And so as we're here this evening, we want to share a little bit about the vision of Hillcrest and what your school's goals are set before us. And so I just want to share three goals that Hillcrest is committed to right now. As a school, with the young people that God entrusts into our care, the goal is to build their faith. build their faith. Wherever they're at, if they're coming to us and they've not yet trusted Jesus Christ, we do not want them to leave their time at Hillcrest without a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. And for those who know and trust him, we want every day to be a day that they grow one step closer to Jesus. So we're strategic in helping provide opportunities for them to grow. Another thing that's very important, because we're a school, is that we want to develop intellect. But I want to tell you something really exciting about the program of developing intellect at Hillcrest right now. We've moved to something called a classical Christian model. And to sum up a lot of fancy educational stuff, it really boils down to this: hold everything to the authority of God's word. So whatever subject matter, we're going to hold it up against the authority of God's word. This is really equipping our young people to enter out into a world that is no longer post-Christian, but really anti-Christian. And so by being able to hold everything in culture against the authority of God's word and shining the light of the authority of God's word to culture, it's going to help them navigate well. So we're really excited about that aspect of education. And then thirdly, we want to strengthen their character. That's what this tour is about. When we take 44 teenagers on a bus for 10 days, there's character strengthening going on. But it's not just in getting along relationally with one another. They are given words in their mouth declaring the praises, the goodness, the power, the strength, and glory of the Lord. And that is their mission to declare. They're practicing and strengthening their evangelism muscles. They know these songs inside and out. They did not get to this point without a lot of practice. So the meaning, the words, the lyrics, the music, it's in their bones. And those words we know are going to stick with them. And they're sharing them as their mission, declaring the praises of God. But secondly, they're building relationships and practicing connecting by being in your homes. And we thank you so much for giving them the opportunity to practice what it means to live as a Christian in community and reach out. They're getting a chance to see churches all across Canada and the United States right now, helping them to see the way congregations look different, the church buildings look different, but the foundation, the cornerstone, Jesus Christ, is the same. And so thank you for putting them in a position where they're learning how to serve and declare the praises of Jesus. Tonight we're going to take an offering to help defray the cost of the tour, and that's something that we just would invite, if you feel led to support the tour in some way, we'd invite you to do that. But I also want to just invite your partnership of remembering Hillcrest. There's really two ways that I'd ask you to remember Hillcrest. If there is someone, you guys can come. Oh, I guess there's no people up here. I'll go on this side of them. There you go. If you know someone that Hillcrest would, it would be the right fit for them. They want a Christian community where they can really build a solid foundation on Jesus Christ, and they can be trained in that Bible camp with homework thing that I was talking about. If you know someone who needs to know more about Hillcrest, please share our website with them, point them to Hillcrest. Kids come from all over, but we need messengers to say, oh, do you know about Hillcrest? We have this school in Fergus Falls, Minnesota. So please share Hillcrest as you know people looking for great options for their teenagers. And then also just remember the ministry that's taking place at Hillcrest. Pray for our teachers. Pray for the families that are making the decision about whether to send their child away. That's a big decision. Pray for them. And know that we're part of this greater Lutheran Brethren family. And we just ask that each person will just remember Hillcrest in your prayers and your support. I'm going to pray for our offering and thank you again for having us here tonight. Lord Jesus, thank you that you are our cornerstone. And I just pray for the students as these words of truth are in their mouth, that they would know it in the depths of their heart, and that it would be a blessing to everyone who hears it. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our next song, Come Find His Rest, by Eric Dewar and Dan Forrest, is an invitation. It says, I came to Jesus as I was, so weary, worn, and sad. I found in him a resting place, and he has made me glad. Each of us is troubled in some way, each chasing after a happiness that is fleeting. However, Jesus opens his arms to us. He beckons us to learn from him, to simply come, to participate in a lasting joy in him. So as we sing this song, I invite you to take up his offer, to lay down your burdens, and in their place find his rest. Our solos for tonight are Ava Renner and Kate Olstead.
Come, weary one, leave thy labors. Come, lift thy head, see thy Savior and friend. His arms are open wide. O soul, be satisfied. Come, find his rest. Take his yoke upon thee, for he is gentle and lowly in heart. So learn from Christ the Lord thy portion and reward. Come find his rest.
Lift thy head, see thy Savior. take his yoke upon me, for he is gentle and lowly in heart. So learn from Christ the Lord thy portion and reward. Come find his rest.
Jesus,
come unto me and rest.
Find his rest.
Come unto
Elijah.
As we close out this evening, I know the students right now would also like to thank their director, Mr. Jonathan Clark. Would you students show him your appreciation for his leadership too? They also build a tremendous relationship with their accompanist, Mrs. Tennyson, and they love her dearly too. So thank you, Mrs. T, as well. I know you kids want to thank her as well. My heart is filled with thankfulness when I get to see teenagers with words of truth in their mouth. And I just, as they were singing the second to the last song, to see them singing these words, I heard the voice of Jesus say, "Come unto me and rest." I found in him a resting place, and he has made me glad. Our story includes a Savior who has come to redeem us. And when he gives us that new identity of child of God, he also gives us purpose. And it's exciting to be gathered tonight to celebrate this God who loves us, redeems us, and then sends us. It's exciting. These students would like to thank you for hosting us, for feeding us. And the best way we know how to say thank you is to sing a blessing over you. So as we close this evening, they're going to sing a benediction, a blessing over you. And that will close out our evening. They're going to just kind of exit the sanctuary, and then in just two or three minutes, they'll come on back in. And if you want to visit with someone, make a connection, you might want to find out if you know them somehow, or you saw a certain face in the choir and you want to connect with them, you can sure do that. And then after a couple more minutes, we'll gather down here in front to match up with our host families. So then the students will move this way. And if you're hosting someone, you can come down here in front too after a few minutes of visiting. So this is how we'll close out our evening. We say thank you, and may the Lord bless you.